everybody, and welcome back to another Wheel of Time video. I'm going to be kicking off a new series today, so let me know what you all think after the video. We're going to be diving into random facts about each book in the series, starting with today's video about the Eye of the World. In this series, I'll give you random facts about either the production of the novel, interesting things you may have missed in the book, or just random things that Robert Jordan said about the book. Before getting into the video, let me give a quick thank you to my channel sponsor, Audible.com. Make sure to click the link in the description below, or just navigate to www.audibletrial.com/Nablus to pick up your free audiobook if you haven't done so already. You get to keep it whether you keep the service or not, and you really help out the growth of the channel just for signing up. Hundreds of you have already signed up this year so far, and I've had a lot of awesome feedback from those of you that are now listening to the Wheel of Time audiobooks. If you haven't already, definitely check it out. So let's drop a spoiler warning for today's video. This video will carry a spoiler rating of red, with spoilers all the way through Winter's Heart. So if you haven't read all the way through Winter's Heart, there will be major spoilers. Please watch at your own risk. So let's kick it off by getting into 12 random facts from The Eye of the World. Number one, The Eye of the World was intended to feel like Lord of the Rings at first. So anyone that reads The Eye of the World and is at least casually familiar with The Lord of the Rings will notice the similarities between the two series at the beginning. You have a remote, idyllic, peaceful farmland, and then riders in black coming to send the reluctant heroes away from their home on a journey to save the world, while guided by the wise wizard and a rough and gritty ranger type figure. This was done completely deliberately. Robert Jordan in many different interviews said that his intention was to take the tropes that Tolkien created with Lord of the Rings, but then give them a completely different spin. So he begins his story with some of the same plot devices, but he then wanted to show what would happen to a character who was given absolute power, but was also told that they would die saving the world and completely break it at the same time. It is this journey that Jordan sets up with Eye of the World, and it all starts with a rider in black chasing some boys. Number two, The Eye of the World took 6 years to write. Robert Jordan started work on The Eye of the World in 1984 after completing a number of novels about Conan the Barbarian. He had pitched the idea of writing a new fantasy series with the concepts of starting with Tolkien and taking it a different direction. He had a number of ideas he wanted to try, but he kept going back to the drawing board with his notes. He really wanted to craft a world that was epic and was deep that he could set his story within. After 6 years of work and multiple edits, he completed Eye of the World, and it was released in January of 1990. Interestingly enough, although it took him 6 years to write Eye of the World, that preparation allowed him to release The Great Hunt, the sequel to The Eye of the World, in the exact same year, coming out in November of 1990. Number three, The Eye of the World was supposed to be the first of three books. When Robert Jordan pitched the series to Tom Doherty at Tor Books, he thought it would be a three-book series with The Eye of the World being the first installment. Tom Doherty so loved the concept for Robert Jordan's books that he immediately signed Jordan to a book deal to write the books. However, rather than a three-book deal, Tom Doherty signed Jordan to a six-book deal. His rationale? He thought Robert Jordan had a tendency to go long when writing and thought that he should give him a few more books. Go long might have been a bit of an understatement, as Robert Jordan ended up writing 12 books himself, and although he planned to finish the series in one long book called A Memory of Light, after he passed away, Brandon Sanderson was so overwhelmed with the notes and the story that he needed to conclude that he ended up splitting the book into three parts. The series ended up being a total of 15 books, so it sounds like Tom Doherty might have been onto something with that go long stuff. But I'm certainly thankful he did. I love how long the series is. To me, that's one of the reasons it's great. Number four, originally, Rand was going to be old. So when Robert Jordan was planning out the story for The Eye of the World, he wanted Rand's character to be an older man rather than a young boy. His original concept was that a man at the end of his life was told that he was the savior of the world and how he would deal with that news. However, after consultation with his editors and giving it some further thought, he decided that having a young character would be more relatable and would present a more compelling story. He believed that an older dragon reborn would likely not value his own life as much, given that he had already lived most of it and would have maturity that a younger character would not have. Ultimately, I'm happy for his decision to make Rand young, as it presented a much more dynamic, much more compelling, and just a better story. Number five, Eye of the World was re-released with new content in 2002. In a bid to reach a young adult audience, Eye of the World was re-released in 2002, but split into two smaller books rather than a single novel. The first of the books was titled From the Two Rivers, and the second book was To the Blight. The thought here was to shorten the novels so that they could attract a younger audience that would get them into the series. As part of the re-release, Robert Jordan included a new prologue for From the Two Rivers that was not previously in The Eye of the World. In fact, many in the Wheel of Time community are unaware of the existence of this extra prologue. I would be willing to bet many of you don't know about it. It is titled Ravens and comes from a young Egwene's point of view. We get to see our main characters in The Two Rivers many years before the start of the novels. I won't spoil it for you if you haven't read it, but it's certainly written for a younger audience. But nevertheless, it gives you an interesting addition to The Eye of the World. I'll have a link in the description to where you can read that additional prologue. Again, down there. Number 6. The Eye of the World was made into a comic book. Between October of 2010 and March of 2013, The Eye of the World was adapted into a 35-issue graphic novel about the story of The Eye of the World. It follows the exact same storyline from the books, and it gives really great visuals to the story. This is one of the first times we see actual canon art from the series. We get to see how the buildings were envisioned and how the characters were, or even how the Shadowspawn were envisioned. I'll have a link to a place where you can view the graphic novels online in the description below as well. Number 7. Rand dominates point of view. Eye of the World is interesting and unique among the Wheel of Time books in that it is so dominated by one point of view. The other books in the series are split in regards to their point of view chapters, bouncing around to some extent through a bunch of the main characters. Eye of the World is for certain an outlier here, as 80% of the chapters in the book are from Rand's point of view. The next closest character is Perrin, with only about 10%. This is the only time in the book series that this is ever so imbalanced, but a lot of it is just due to building the character of Rand so that he can become our savior character. Number 8. We hear a Trolloc speak. Eye of the World is the only time in the entire series that we hear anything other than animal guttural sounds from Trollocs. We get to hear one Trolloc actually speak at the beginning of the novel. On Winter Night, as the Althor farm is being attacked, Narg the Trolloc speaks to Rand. He attempts to convince Rand to come with him using such persuasive language as Narg Smart. Narg has become a meme in the Wheel of Time community, and it is all due to being the only Trolloc that we hear speak. I'm not sure whether he was really that smart, or whether other Trollocs could talk but just don't in the books. Either way, this stands out as something entirely unique to The Eye of the World. Number 9. Rand channels the whole book. Something that you may not have caught on your first read-through is that Rand actually channels multiple times in the book without even realizing it. I know my first time reading through, I didn't put a lot of this together. We learn from Moraine that when someone first channels, there's sickness and side effects involved. The channeler can experience rushes of energy and become reckless, as well as get extremely ill with fever and chills. These side effects typically happen around 10 days after the first time someone channels, and every time the channeler experiences this, the sickness will come closer and closer to the time of channeling, until it's instantaneous and disappears entirely. We see this in Rand a number of times throughout the book, so let me show you a few examples. The first time we see it is when they're escaping the Two Rivers, and Rand channels to help Bella run longer and faster. It becomes somewhat obvious if you know what to look for on a reread. Around 7 days later, he has a rush of exhilaration in Baerlon when confronting the White Cloaks. This was his first reaction to channeling. Later, he channels while escaping Shadar Logoth on boarding the Spray. He channels to make the boom of the Spray hit a Trolloc that was chasing them as he was boarding Bael Doman's boat. Around 4 days after this, Rand experiences exhilaration again as he climbs to the top of the mast and begins tumbling around on the rigging. The next time he channels is in the inn in Four Kings when they are trapped by the Dark Friends. He calls Lightning to help he and Matt escape. Around 2 days later, he gets extremely ill with fever and chills as he and Matt are in Market Sharon. And we last see him channel at the Eye of the World when using Sidene at the Eye. This time around, we don't see any major reaction, meaning that he may have passed his sickness at this point. It's just really cool to see this happening all along, and most readers, they really don't put it together what's actually happening on their first read-through. Number 10. Ishamael set up the whole climax. It's interesting that we find out at the end of the novel that Ishamael, at this point in time still calling himself Baal-Alzamon, or however you pronounce that, orchestrated all of the events to lead the party to the Eye of the World. He was the person that made sure they heard of the Eye in their dreams. He made sure the Aiel told the Tinkers. He made sure that Jane Farstrider told the Ogier. He mentions that he did this, but it begs an interesting question as to why he did this. We never really get a straight answer to it, actually. There is speculation about him wanting Rand to become the dragon so he could turn him, or that he needed them to lead him to the Eye, or a number of other theories. These would actually make an interesting fan theory video that I'll probably do here soon, but it is certainly not by chance that the group ends up at the Eye of the World. Number 11. All the information to cleanse Sidene is in the eye of the world. Robert Jordan is truly a master of subtle foreshadowing and dropping clues in his novels. He gives all the information necessary to cleanse Sidene here in Book 1. For example, the Eye of the World is a pool of untainted Sidene that was created through the use of male and female channelers working together to make it purer, but all dying in the process. The Eye is proof that the taint can be filtered out from Sidene. The place that the taint would be cleansed is also introduced in this book in the ancient city of Shadar Logoth. Rand doesn't get the idea of evil fighting evil until much later, but the concept of the evil of Shadar Logoth attracting the shadow is introduced in this book as well in Matt's Ruby Dagger, a remnant of Shadar Logoth, that attracts Murdral as they chase Rand and Matt, and it later attracts Balthamel and Aghanor to the Eye of the World. It's stated that that dagger and that evil will attract the other evil of the shadow. It is the attraction of evil to evil that Rand uses to cleanse the source later in Shadar Logoth in Book 9, and all of that information was shared for the most part in Book 1. Number 12, The Creator Speaks. The Eye of the World is possibly the only book in the series that we might hear the Creator speak directly to Rand. There's a scene at the end of the book when Rand is at the Eye about to fight Ishamael, and a voice says, "It is not here. I will take no part. Only the Chosen One can do what must be done, if he will." Rand talks back to the voice, asking, "Where?" And the voice replies, "Not here," before a set of stairs appear and he climbs them to fight Ishamael. It's a strange sequence that's a bit hard to understand and is never really explicitly explained. We don't know for sure that it's the Creator talking, but it's generally assumed that that's what Robert Jordan intended, and then later changed his mind to have the Creator be more absent from the story in the later books. So there's 12 random facts from the Eye of the World. Let me know what you think of my list in the comments below, and let me know if you've got any interesting facts from the Eye of the World that you think should have been included as well. If you are enjoying the content, please give the video a like, as it really helps with the algorithm and helping the channel grow. Also, hit that subscribe button so you can be updated when I release new stuff. If you want to support the channel, please consider checking out my Patreon page. There are Patreon-only rewards and content there if you're a patron. I've been recreating maps for the series, some of which have never been created before as far as I can tell, and my patrons have access to all of those maps as I get them completed. You can find the link for my Patreon in the description below. Thank you all for watching, and until next time, peace out.
Tinker in the kitchen with a job of work to do. Mistress up above, slipping on a rope of blue. She prances down the staircase, a fancy oh so free, crying, "Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me?" Tinker asks the mistress, "Don't you got a labour man?" "Yes," but she replied, "he lacks your talent and your hands. And I can tell you got the skill to hit the spots you see. So Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me?" Tinker said the neighbour boy can probably get it done. He's far too inexperienced, I'll never go that young. I'm sure he can be broken in or taught, but he's too sweet. So Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? The mistress asked the tinker, "Can you help me move the chairs? They're just a bit too heavy and they need to go upstairs." She bats her eyes, the tinker sighs, then picks them up with ease. So Tinker, manly Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? The mistress told the tinker, "There's a problem with me bed. It's rough and full of lumps, the thought of sleep fills me with dread. I'm sure if we just roll around, I'd cry aloud in glee. So Tinker, handsome Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me?" Tinker in his small clothes while he's underneath the sheets. When the sound of footsteps in the kitchen start to creak, he's unaware, "Don't use the stair or you'll get caught and beat." So Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? "Come on now, go use the window, no need for him to see." So Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? Tinker, oh dear Tinker, won't you mend a pot for me? Hey!